Fantastic. So we will talk about now about data collection and data processing. Well, we don't have much time, sorry. But let me start with some examples. And I applied these samples on light pollution projects, citizen science projects. I think they are very illustrative of the kind of things we can do for collecting data. So well, we'll start. So basically light pollution is the use of excessive artificial lights, okay? So basically, if you are in a town, you don't see practically the stars, okay? You see a very, like a snow globe, no? There's a lot of light in the sky, okay? That's the problem with light pollution. So, well, the astronomers that was the most implicated researchers in light pollution start to think, okay, we have to measure this sky, no? The brightness of the sky. So what does as you see in the stars, there is a property that is the magnitude. Okay, so the magnitude measure the brightness of the sky of the stars. It depends of the distance of the star. Okay, and of course as the intrinsic brightness of the of these celestial object. So the astronomers say, okay, so if I want to share, if I want to measure the brightness of the sky, I'm just keeping an eye of the stars, and I can say, okay, so if the brightness of the sky, the magnitude of this star is, I don't know, 20, for example, and I can see it, okay, it's because there is a light pollution there. So they're running a citizen science project, okay, this is Globe at night. So basically it's to say to the people, okay, I want to measure the light pollution, not only, okay, in the astronomical observatories, I want to measure the light pollution around the world. So I will ask to the people that go outside and see what is the kind of a star that they see, okay? And this is a very typical citizen science project, a very citizen science technique, okay? So, well, the people do it. You have, you can see there are a lot of measurements about the brightness of the sky. But as you can imagine, there is a problem because, well, if you say to the people, okay, you see the, I don't know, the Aldebaran star, but I don't know what is it, okay? So you need experts, okay? So, well, you can take measurements, but you need some expertise. You have to train these citizens, okay? So you can imagine that the quality of the results are not good ones, okay? So, and this is very interesting. Some guys say, Christopher Kaiba, and Sibyl knows very well this project, this is Lost of the Night, this is one of the pilots in action, say, okay, well, I have a problem. People doesn't know where is the star, but I have a very nice application, Lost of the Night, that with a mobile phone, people, citizens, can identify the stars. And they can see, tell me if they can see the star or not. And of course, they can give me more information because it is not only to see the star, but imagine that there is a cloud, okay, between the stars and you, okay? So there's a cloud, so the sky is cloudy. So you cannot see the star, but not for the brightness. It's about there's a cloud between you. So with this application, you can move, go directly to the star and say to the server or to the searcher, okay, I can't see or I can't see this specific star. So you can imagine that we improve the quality, okay? So you can imagine that in data collection, it is very important the process you get for getting these results, okay? And of course, there's another problem with this application because, well, you can identify the stars, but the problem is if you want to observe the stars, you have to be on the darkness, okay, for maybe 10 minutes for your eyes, okay, because you have to see this star, you have to, and it's this period of time. But the problem is if you are using a mobile application, okay, well, you receive the light of the mobile phone, Okay, there is no better in this because the design is very good and they use not very brightness colors. Okay, but this is still a problem. But the quality, you improve the quality of the Globe at Night project. Another kind. So in this case, okay. So well, there is a problem. I will try to measure the brightness of the sky and just looking for stars. Oof, but it's very complicated because, well, there is a problem associated, as I said. So one guy say, okay, so I have a mobile phone. There is a camera. All the mobile phones has a camera. So can I use these images taken with this camera to calculate this light pollution? Boom. So this is the idea. And this guy is not a researcher. It's basically a person who is very interested in light pollution. This is a software engineer, okay? But they come up with this idea. So they use the application is Dark Sky Meter. So with the mobile phone, okay, they take measurements from the sky, okay? So this is another approach. So imagine that our final goal is to make a measurement from the brightness of the sky. So we are using citizens, okay? And for the one hand, we use, we will try to identify stars in the sky, but the other one is, well, I'm going to take an image and I'm going to calculate this magnitude based on the pixels of the image, okay? With the information retrieved by the CMOS sensor, the sensor of the camera, okay? Well, one of the problems of this application, I think the developer is correct right now, is that, well, the range of cameras is too wide, okay? There's a lot of Android mobile phones, okay? And the range of this camera is too much. But for example, if you use an iPhone, for example, all the cameras in an iPhone are the same, not in the Android case, okay? But in the iPhone, starts with the same. So this is another way to collect data, okay? People, eyes, right now a mobile application. Well, there's another project, very interesting. Rafael knows very well, and the people from UCM. So basically in this project, they say, okay, so instead of taking the measurement from a specific point of the sky, I'm going to take all the celestial pole, okay? We are going to take measurements from different points of the sky to build this map that you can see here. And I'm going to use this specific device. This is a hardware, it's open hardware, okay? So everybody can download the schematics, okay? And build this device if they want, okay? One of the process, and probably Laria comments later, is the calibration. When you build a device, you have to calibrate the device because you need that all device take the same measurements, okay? In the same situation, in the same conditions, okay? This is very important. This is a very important part of the device for the design of the device. And this is one of the problems I think in citizen science project. This because when the people start to build devices, they don't calibrate in the same condition in the same place, okay? And that's really a problem for their researcher point of view, no? Scientific point of view. So one of the things we happen with this device, this basically is a photometer, is, well, the process to take all the measurements is a little bit annoying because you can see me right there on the left image, okay? So you have to take different measurements, etc. So this is a process that you will take, I don't know, 20 minutes for me to take all the measurements in the celestial bowl. Well, there's the problem in citizen science project is if the process to collect data is too complex or require a lot of time, the people are not going to do it. Only some crazy people like me, for example, but we are only me and Rafael, maybe. Okay, so one of the participants in this citizen science project say, okay, yes, I don't want to do that, but I have some knowledge about robotics. Okay, so I'm going to build a robotic arm, and he did it. Okay, they build a robotic arm that take measurements automatically. So this is an amazing device. I saw it, how it works. And basically you put the device, you push the button, okay? And I don't know, in 2-3 minutes, you have all the measurements. So this is a kind of device that everybody can use, okay? Well, this is the photometer, okay? Well, using a hardware is very good for monitoring the light pollution, okay? In this case, the light pollution. If you take measurements, what the problem with citizen science project is, well, the people can take measurement, for example, the soil, etc. Okay, but there are doing in a specific point of time, and probably you will need to monitor all the measurements, not taking one day and the next measurement will take in, I don't know, in the next month, etc. You need more measurements along the time, no? Because you need to see the evolution during the time, okay? So this is a good practice to deploy sensors. There are a lot of dashboards associated with the sensor, that database visualization we'll talk about in the other blocks, okay? Go faster. This is not exactly data collection, this is more like data processing, okay? So in citizen science project, most of the projects are related with data collection. So we are going to collect data, we are going to analyze, or we are going to send this data to researchers, and they are going to make some analysis, studies, and publish them. Okay. So in this case, this is Cities at Night. This is a project where in the International Space Station, okay, one of the astronomers are very, they like a lot photographs, etc. So they take photographs from the International Space Station, okay? So you know that the International Station is orbit around the Earth, okay? So one of the researchers on light pollution say, wow, this is a very interesting material, okay? To study the light pollution, not from the Earth's point of view, it's from the sky, okay? From the space, okay? But there was a little bit problem because, well, the astronaut take a lot of photographs, and in NICE repositories, there is thousands and thousands and thousands of images. But the photograph, the astronaut not only take photos from the cities, that is the important thing for a researcher, they take photos from the space, Aurora Borealis, the arm of the International Space Station, etc. So, well, in this case, the researcher only needs the collection of images of the Earth, of the cities, but the work to classify thousands and thousands and thousands of images are huge. So he said, okay, so I'm going to create a citizen science project, and with the crowdsourcing techniques, I'm going to publish all these images, okay? And I go to allow to citizens that classify these images. So basically in this application, this application is built like with gamification techniques. Irene can tell you more about this application because it was developed by the Cheffrel team in other project. So basically where the citizens can do is, well, I see an image and I have to say, okay, this is a city, this is an aurora, stars, etc. So if you show same image to different persons, you can establish that you can get the results of this classification. If, I don't know, if 80% of the people say that this image corresponds to a city, you can say, okay, this is a city, and you will say, and you send these results to the researchers. So this is another way to process data, not process it with algorithms, we can say with computers, we can use the people as computers, okay? And this is part of the data processing. There are a wide range of citizen science projects, especially in the Zooniverse platform, to deal with this kind of projects, okay? So, just a small question. What do you understand by data collection? I would like to know your feeling. Looking for a lot of projects which involves data collection is that the methodology to collect data has a huge impact in the quantity of quality of your data. For example, the case of Globe at Night. Well, you have a lot of quantity of data, 180,000 measurements, but the quality is not very good, okay? In the case of Lost of the Night, we improve the quality, okay? Maybe the quantity is not much, okay? But the quality of these measurements are better, okay? So I think that the methodology, and it's very important, do we follow to collect this data? There's a huge impact on these two parameters of the data, okay? That's my impression and my perspective. So I always say, be always open to new ideas, okay? You have to trust in your participants, okay? Because as I saw you in some of the examples, they always have a crazy idea, okay? And you always have to evaluate this idea. Don't close your mind to new ideas, okay? Of course, there are some ideas that are really, really, really crazy. But sometimes the other participants in your project has a very good idea, but not the implementation of this idea is not very clear. And I think this is always important to listen to the ideas and try together, okay, to refine this idea and try to implement it, okay? Because, well, most of the citizen science projects always see the participant like data collectors. I only want to collect data. I don't care about your ideas or how to improve the process, okay? Just collect, and collect data, okay? And it is important to see if we can improve the process to collecting data, because I think one of the pillars to measure if a citizen science project is going to be successful or not, okay, is the way that we collect data, okay? So we are going to show you two tools to collect data. I'm going to be very fast because I've seen Kat in the video. So one of the tools is EpiCollect. So basically EpiCollect consists on created web forms, okay, to collect this data. So you will see here, this is based on mobile phones, as I say. It works with Android and iOS, okay, systems. And citizens can create their own projects, and you basically have to drag and drop components. So basically, if you want a photo, okay, that this means that the citizen sent you a photo, you only have to track the photo component in the web form. And automatically, when the citizens see the form, there will be a photo element, photo component to take this photo, okay? That's very easy to use. There is text box, locations, etc. So it can collect different kind of data like text, buttons, and a specific date, time, location, okay? The GPS is integrated in the application, and any kind of multimedia resource like photos, videos, or even sounds. You want to, I don't know, imagine that you want to collect the sounds of the birds, okay? You can do it with this application. So basically it's consist in move components that you need information. So this is the case of EpiCollect applied to the street expector. So automatically when the user create this web form, they publish this web form in the application in EpiCollect, and everybody can start to collect data, okay? And automatically this data is sent to our servers, okay? And everybody can consult this data, okay? Like in a table format or in a map format, okay? Well, what is the advantage to use this tool is, well, I don't have to pay a software developer to make a specific application to collect data, because sometimes it could be very problematic, okay? Always in software developer, there are, you have to pass a lot of tests, etc. Okay, they take a lot of time to develop an application, and you need, of course, money. In this case, you don't need even resources. All the resources, we can say computer resources, are in external repositories, okay, external servers, okay? and the application is done. You only have, as a designer, to define what is the kind of information that you are going to collect, okay? And you just download, not only you, everyone, every participant can download the information that is generated in on real time, okay? That's, so this is a way to transparency. And also, for example, for collecting data, you need the, of course, the EpiCollect application in present in iOS or in Android. So one of the cool things is, well, there is a huge community if an EpiCollect, so you don't need to looking for users, okay? Or any consent form or whatever, okay? This is included in the application form, this is included in the application. You only have to take care if you are going to collect personal data or not, okay? You can find here below the URL of the project what we created for Street Spectra, okay? Well, you can see how it works. Well, so this is like the builder to design and to create the forms that I mentioned in EpiCollect, okay? As you can see, it is very easy to use, okay? You see in the left part of the of the browser, the different components of your form, and you just to drag and drop to your form, okay? So basically, in this case, for example, you can see a component of date. So the user will see a calendar where they can pick up a specific date for this observation, okay? So you always have to think that EpiCollect is always to record observations, okay? So you can define very interesting things in these components, like for example, city, niche, and answer to current date. So does it mean that where the user start to use the form to record all the observations, they will see that the calendar is filling it with the current date. Okay, that is very useful because if the user have to pick up all the time the date is a little bit annoying. Okay, and also you can configure the time. Okay, it's similar to date. For example, you can define the format of your time. Okay, and also you can set the day initial answer. Okay, so. No, I don't want to choose a specific time, just use the current time. Location, okay? So if you use the component of the location, you will see in this application, in your mobile phone, that you only have to pick up in the current location, okay? And the application will fill in this field, okay, with your current location. So it is very easy to configure a form to collect data, okay? And it's always the same. You can take images, but if you see the different components of the EpiCollect, you will see that you have photo, audio, video, even a barcode, okay? That's a lot of possibilities to register any kind of data, okay? Finally, you can add, for example, observations. So imagine that you are in a place. In this case, in EpiCollect with a Street Spectra, basically you are going to a place. Select the current date and time, your location, and you take a picture. Okay. And of course, in the observation, you can add additional information like, I don't know, maybe this lamppost is broken or I don't know, any other kind of information that it could be relevant for the researchers. Okay. And when all the form is always complete, then you can publish and everybody that has installed the application of EpiCollect, we will start to take measurements or take observations with this application, okay, with this project. And also, do you see the new screen with the table? Yes, perfect. So where the citizens send the observations, okay, to EpiCollect, everyone can see all the observation taken by the application. For example, in this case, this is our record, okay? All the observations, as you can see, there is a identifier, okay? A unique identifier, okay? That's really important. Date, well, this guy put the name, okay? But you will see here the location of the place and the photo. And you can click in the photo and see the photo taken by the users, okay? So it's very easy to configure. And I want to say that if you need an application for, you only need one day to configure all the application and to run your pilot. And of course, you can download the data, okay? But in different formats, CSV or JSON file, or you can choose the time frame, I don't know, the lifetime of the project, today, last 7 days, or you can choose the period of time in a calendar, etc. Okay, so you can download the data, but everybody can download the data. It's total fully transparency. And also you can see the all the observations in a table or in a map, okay? So you can click here on the map and you can go, for example, from to Madrid, this one, well, let's see, this is a bit, and if you click in one particular observation, you will see all the data associated, okay? Including the photo, okay? So this is very easy to create an application, a mobile application to start recording data, okay? Another application interesting, this is not for collecting data, it's more for processing data. If you remember the project of Cities at Night, okay? To basically consist on classify images. We create with Suniverse platform a project that is is complementary to Epic Collect, because for example, in Epic Collect, the people start to record is basically upload images from Spectra. You will see here in your screen the Spectra. So with Suniverse, we upload the images generated in Epic Collect, okay? And we define a specific workflow with different tasks to classify this information. Right now, the workflow we have in Street Spectra in Suniverse, there are two different tasks. The first task, and you can see here, is to mark the spectrum of the lamppost. So in this case, the spectrum of this lamppost is this one. So you can easily, okay, select this region of interest, we can say, okay? And we can move to the next one. And in the next question, the next, we can say next task, okay? Sorry, the citizen in this case has to choose, okay, the type of lamp used that generates a spectra. I would say, I think it's, well, I don't remember. I think, well, I would say Mercury, okay? And just done. Okay, so this information is sent on Suniverse and you can download all this information. So what is the result? So you have images taken with Epic Collect, you upload these images to Suniverse, and with Suniverse, you can classify all this spectrum in the different categories of the lamps, okay? Of the lamp of the lamppost, okay? So, well, this is another exercise. And of course, when you upload the images, a task is generated automatically in Suniverse, and this task is delivered to different users, not only one user. Remember what we are talking about, citizen science project. And in this case, in particular, this case in the data processing, okay, this is very useful to show the same task to different person. And you can establish in Suniverse the number of person that you want to deliver this concrete task, okay? And this is also a way, as you can imagine, and Ilaria probably commented in data quality, it is a way to validate the data, because you imagine that you are using Epic Collect. Well, people normally used to upload images from the spectrum, but well, I can upload images from my cat or my dog or whatever, okay? So using this task to processing these images, okay, you can validate these results and you can filter the images that it doesn't that are not relevant for the project, okay? So, well, this is the tools that I want to show you, okay? So I'm going to give the floor to Ilaria to talk about Coni, that is another tool to collect data, okay?
I added this video because we don't have time to try by yourself, Coni. But of course, I'll give you the link. So if you would like to do it in the break or in the afternoon, you can. Coni is a tool to create a survey, and like, but not a traditional survey, But as you can see in the video, this is a chat interface, more engaging way to provide surveys and in a more interactive way. This is a quantitative method to collect information, because you have a lot of possibility to create different questions and to collect different answers. We have buttons, checkbox, star rating, slider, and emoji. But we can also ask for open questions. The user experience is more like a storytelling, and there is a possibility to set also the language. The advantages to use this type of tool is that is demonstrated that the user like Connie more than traditional surveys. We did studies, and we also have some publication if you wanted to go in deep on this topic. And the attention during the compilation is increased, also from feedback, direct feedback from users, who say that is a really novel way of answering questions and is really valid and reliable as a traditional survey. So the interaction doesn't affect the result. And then to present you, this is really a short introduction. You can write to me if you want to have more information. But Connie is divided in three separate parts. There is the chat, the web-based responsive user interface to deliver the chat. So what you see, what I showed in the first slide, what you see when you fill the survey. There is the Connie Create area, that is this one, when you can drag and drop boxes to create questions, answers, or free text to be included in your surveys. Is really, really easy to use and quite fast to be implemented. And then there is Connie Inspect, which is the live dashboard that show the main data collected, the main summary of data collected, and some sort of first level of statistics, and when you can download also the data you collected. And I would like also to give you a fast view. Okay, this is the tool. I would like to just see how much it's easier to create, I don't know, questions box. You can type here. And then you can select the type of answer. So for example, or checkbox, you can add the type of answer, and then multiple answer if needed, and so on. Also, none of the above is one of the preset answer. And this is an example of a complete survey. This is the example of the motivational survey I introduced you yesterday. But we of course can help you also in this activity, creating survey together if needed. Okay, this is an example with emoji. This is an example with star rating. And we have multiple answer, or also somewhere there is also checkbox, I saw. But this is a complete survey. Okay, it seems too big, but it's not so difficult to create it. Okay, you can do it when you want. Thank you. I don't know, Irene, do you want to add something?
No. I think you covered everything. The main message is, if you need in your pilot to create surveys to collect any kind of information from your participant or the general public or whatever, this is an alternative way to make a survey. And it's from the user experience point of view, is as Hilary was explaining, is much better. And we can of course not only provide you with a tool, but also with some help in how to design and construct the questionnaire in the most effective way in order to collect the data in an efficient way. And of course, all the GDPR concerns that we were discussing before also applies to this.